Good afternoon, everyone. Wow, that's quite loud, isn't it? Yes. Welcome to St. Mary's College. My name is Michael Waddell, and I am the director of the Master of Autism Studies program here at St. Mary's. It's my privilege to welcome you to the second annual Autism Studies lecture. This series, which was inaugurated last year with a visit from Temple Grandin, is supported in part by a generous endowment gift from the Peter B. and Adeline Ruffin Foundation in New York. We're very fortunate to have as our speaker this year, Professor Francesca Happé from King's College London. Professor Happé has been an author on more than 300 articles and has written or edited 5 books, including Girls and Autism, Education, Family, and Personal Perspectives, and Autism, A New Introduction to Psychological Theory and Current Debate, which has been translated into 5 languages. She has served as president of the International Society for Autism Research, as a member of the Neurodevelopmental Disorders Working Group for DSM-5, and as an editor or board member of many of the top journals in the field, including the Journal of Autism and Developmental Disorders and the Lancet Psychiatry. She's been awarded the British Psychological Society's Spearman Award for Early Career Achievement, the Royal Society's Rosalind Franklin Award, which she used to develop a set of children's books promoting female scientists, and the British Psychological Society President's Award. She's a fellow of the British Academy and the Academy of Medical Sciences, and has been named a commander of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire, an honor which I believe she shares with Stephen Hawking and Helena Bonham Carter. Quite good company. I wouldn't mind being dinner with that group. Throughout her career, Professor Happé's work has been concerned with social understanding and mentalizing, or theory of mind. In recent years, her work has focused on several issues that are near to my heart: autism and adulthood, including late adulthood, autism and mental health, and of course, girls and women on the spectrum. In fact, it was when I began studying girls and women on the spectrum that I first became aware of Frankie's work. She was one of the first people to dig into this relatively new area of research, and her work has helped us to learn about critical factors in the lives of autistic girls and women, including disparities in screening and diagnosis, camouflaging, and compensatory strategies. So it's a special pleasure for me to have Professor Happé here today to speak on Misdiagnosed and Misunderstood, Women and Girls on the Autism Spectrum. Please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you very much, Michael. And I'm really honored to be invited here to give this lecture. And I'm aware that there's a lot of expertise in this room, so I'm going to leave lots of time for questions, and I really hope you will ask questions and raise your own perspectives, because that's where I can learn from all of you. So in the next 40 minutes or so, I'm going to raise the question, are we missing autistic women and girls, and give you some evidence that I think we are. I'm going to dig into some reasons why we might be missing or historically have under-recognized autism in women and girls, and 4 different kinds of explanations, which include camouflaging, as Michael's alluded to. I want to tell you about a study we did listening to the voices of autistic women and girls, and finish with some conclusions. And if there's time, I'd like to play you a very short film, about a 5-minute film, again, to give the final voice to autistic women and girls. Have some conclusions, and I really look forward to your questions. So we have to remember, of course, as you all know, that autism is a behavioral diagnosis. The traditional triad allowed us to recognize autism when we saw social difficulties and differences, communication difficulties, and rigid and repetitive behaviors and/or interests. In DSM-5, that became the triad, but we're still dealing with behaviors. We're still looking at how somebody is interacting and judging, is this autism? We don't have any kind of biomarker, or we don't have a cognitive probe that is reliable. And that leads to some difficulties, because if diagnosis depends on recognizing the features, how well we recognize those features, how broadly we recognize the different manifestations of those features is going to determine the boundaries for where we make diagnosis. And I hope that'll come clear as we talk about the possibly different manifestation in women and girls. So autism, is it underrecognized in females? Well, the traditional view, and I think this is true even maybe 10 years ago or even more recently, that we were operating with a male to female ratio estimated at 5 males to 1 female. And in the days when we used to talk about Asperger syndrome, people often said that among individuals with very good intellectual functioning, those who might have an Asperger label, there might be 10 times as many males as females. We believed that that females were more likely to have autism plus intellectual disability, so that although women were less likely to get a diagnosis of autism when they did, they were more likely to have high support needs. But all of these estimates, all of these numbers, were from people known to clinical services or known to special educational needs services, people who had managed to jump the hurdles to get that diagnosis. And as I want to say later, if we only do research with those who are already diagnosed, there's a risk of circularity. So progress has been made more recently, as reflected in literature and a systematic review and meta-analysis, suggesting that the male-to-female ratio is probably more like 3 males to 1 female, and that the ratio is actually quite similar across the intellectual level span, so not this big difference between those with and without intellectual disability, although that is debated. These estimates now are coming from epidemiological studies with active ascertainment. So we don't wait to see who's managed to get a diagnosis. We go into the population and we see who would meet diagnostic criteria if you ask the right questions. And if you look at that difference between 4 or more to 1 and 3 to 1, with looking at registers of diagnosed people and looking at epidemiological estimates, I think we have to come to the conclusion that historically, we've been missing at least thousands of women and girls who would meet diagnostic criteria for autism. And the time trends in autism diagnosis are interesting. So I'm just showing you a very recent study from the UK, looking over the last 20 years. And we all know that the rates of autism diagnosis are increasing, and people have discussed different reasons for that. In this particular study, where they were able to look at like-for-like medical records and doctor's records, they found that the really steep rise, split by gender, the steep rise is in female diagnoses. And also interestingly, if you split by age group, the steep rise is in first diagnosis over the age of 19, that green line. And the authors, Ginny Russell and co., conclude from this that it's not that we're overextending the diagnosis, but rather that we're catching up on historically neglected groups, historically neglected females and individuals who've been missed in childhood and are now being recognized post-19. So we can ask, what is the research evidence that autism is less well recognized in females? We know that at similar levels of symptom severity or behavioral signs of autism, females are less likely to be diagnosed than their male peers. We know that girls who get the diagnosis often have other red flags that are bringing them to attention, such as ADHD or intellectual disability, and that that makes a difference between girls who get a diagnosis and girls with similar levels of autistic traits who don't get a diagnosis. But that isn't true for boys. So for girls, it seems you have to have some extra red flag to get attention. And we know that on average, females are identified later than males on the autism spectrum. This is some very recent evidence from two large data sets from the States, and showing in a childhood sample, so these were entering the study on average around age 10 or 11, so childhood sample, but showing that females indeed were later diagnosed on average than males. Here, a difference of around 14 months on average, but there'll be a big range around that. So in two separate samples. And the authors ask the interesting question, what demographic or other characteristics help us to predict that difference by sex in age of diagnosis? So here's one characteristic they had, which was the severity of rigid and repetitive behavior and interests, or the extremity, one should say, maybe more than severity. And what they show is that it's when those RRBIs are particularly low that you get this big delay in diagnosis for girls compared to boys. Not significant where there are more pronounced RRBIs. They looked at two other characteristics. So in the SPARC sample, they looked at language level. They found significant differences at all language levels, but only really a big effect size in delay in diagnosis for those who have good language, above expected language functioning. And in terms of IQ, again, the same. It's in those who have high IQ, who have average and above IQ, where the girls are really late to get the diagnosis compared to the boys. So I want to turn to why we might have under-recognized autism in women and girls. And the first reason I want to suggest is a knowledge gap. We don't know what we don't know, and most research has involved predominantly, and sometimes solely, boys and men, which means that what we think we know about autism from those studies is really what we know about autism in men and boys. So you can understand why this was the case. If historically people were working with an estimated male-to-female ratio of 10 to 1, and you're planning a neuroimaging study with maybe 30 participants, and you think you're going to get 3 women taking part, and you can't analyze those 3 separately, and you're going to get criticized for mixing them in with the men, you're just not going to recruit those women. And unfortunately, historically, that's often what has happened. So why does it matter? Well, our research, of course, feeds into our diagnostic criteria and our diagnostic processes. So if we're working with male bias data, then the diagnostic processes we have and the criteria may not be fair to both or to all genders. A second reason is, I think, that we all carry with us something of a male autism stereotype. And I have to say that this was true for me as well. I worked in autism research for over 30 years. And about 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, I suddenly stopped and thought, that woman in the playground when our kids were tiny, who would come and talk to me, was really friendly, like we knew each other really, really well, but that wasn't quite my perception of how we knew each other, and we'd maybe stand a bit too close or talk about something I couldn't quite follow because she hadn't given me the premise. She's autistic. Of course she is. Why didn't I see it? Now I see it. It's obvious that she's autistic, but at the time, even with, at that point, 15 years of autism experience, I didn't see it because although I'd met autistic women and girls, I'd met so many more autistic boys and men that really colored my perception. And I have to say, about a week ago, I went and gave a talk about autism, actually where my husband works for their neurodiversity and carers group. And at the end, a woman came up to me, a young woman, absolutely immaculately dressed, beautiful hair and makeup, and said to me, I'm so glad you told me all that. It fits exactly my experience. I've been diagnosed this year. And she went on to say about how difficult social things were for her, even though academically and in her job she was acing it. And I just thought, you know, nobody would look at that woman and think autism. It's just not the stereotype we have. Of course, she is autistic, and we need to incorporate all of those different manifestations, all of those different faces of autism. But it's not the common stereotype of autism. And so more generally, I think we carry those unconscious biases. And when a teacher or a parent or even a clinician in some places sees a socially awkward boy, they do now think, could this be autism? But when they see a socially awkward girl, they really are more likely to think, is it social anxiety? Are they just shy? And some of that has been well documented in terms of, you know, if you look at children in the playground, you can often see that the autistic little boy is walking the perimeter while the other boys are playing some sort of sports, whereas the girls are all in little clusters having a chat about things, and the autistic girl is there, apparently joining in, but slightly on the periphery, maybe not, you know, laughing at the same time as the others, maybe a bit uncomfortable, but if you just look across the playground, they don't stick out. And also, if you have a look at this, at the picture, if you can see it, or the lined up cars. We see lined up cars, we think autism. If you see lined up cuddly toys, lined up soft toys, teddy bears, or dolls, do you think autism, or do you think, oh, how sweet? To line them all up, maybe she's going to teach them or talk to them or something. So I think we need to really check our biases, and that's certainly been something I've needed to do over the last few years. Part of that is that because we don't think of autism as the first thing we think of in relation to women, often other diagnoses will overshadow the autism. So a particularly prominent example are eating disorders. And at the eating disorders, the anorexia clinics at the Mozzie Hospital, where I am associated with, they found that around 20 to 30% of the women who come with anorexia have an undiagnosed autistic condition. Now, that means that when they give them the ADOS or some other assessment, they would score up, they would pass diagnostic criteria for autism. They are cautious about the fact that we know that when you are at starvation weight, that affects your general cognition and your social cognition specifically. But I think the evidence is beginning to emerge that even when weight is returned to normal, a lot of these women still show a lot of traits of autism, probably to a diagnostic threshold. Why does this matter? Well, sometimes the drivers of an eating disorder in autism will be very, very different, and I'm happy to talk about that if you want to ask questions. Now, that means that instead of a clinician seeing the anorexia, which is sex stereotype congruent, and stopping there, they need to ask, is this anorexia in the context of autism? And we know that, of course, in other cases, the overshadowing diagnosis will actually be a misdiagnosis. So it may be a misdiagnosis of a personality disorder or of maybe just anxiety without recognizing that's extreme anxiety in the context of autism. A third reason why autism may be underdiagnosed in women and girls is the possibility that autism might look a little bit different in some women and girls. And I want to say in some women and girls or on average, because I do want to emphasize that, of course, there will be autistic men and boys who show a somewhat atypical presentation, maybe a bit more like we often talk about with girls on average. And there will be autistic girls who show an absolutely classic, you know, traditional, stereotypical almost, presentation of autism. So these are only, as all sex differences, only on average. But some of the suggestions there have been about on average sex differences is that, for example, social style may be a bit different. So whereas the common concept of social difficulties in autism would be being socially aloof, some autistic girls and women will be socially clingy. There's one girl, one friend who's actually essential and they can't be separated from. And that doesn't look like many people's stereotype of autism. Special interests may also look more ordinary or be more ordinary in terms of their focus. So if a clinician is assessing a 15-year-old boy, and they ask them, what are you interested in? And he says, electricity pylons, and can I show you all my photographs of electricity pylons? The clinician will probably have a red flag thinking, could be autism. If the clinician asks a 15-year-old girl, what are you interested in? And she says, she names a boy band, or says Kate Winslet, or some other actress, or names a particular breed of pony, he may well say, well, that's just like any other girl. But if he asked a bit more, he'd find out that actually maybe she just collects facts about Kate Winslet, doesn't actually want to watch her films, or is fascinated by this breed of pony, but all other kinds of pony are completely boring to her. So the intensity or the narrowness is autistic in its character. And in terms of general reviews of possible differences, it seems that rigid and repetitive behaviors and interests in general look a bit more prominent in boys than in girls. Although in parent-rated social and RRBI traits in adolescence, parents actually rate girls as showing more of these than boys. Now, whether that's parental sensitivity or some of our societal norms, it could also be, as has been suggested, that actually there are differences in trajectory and timing. So this is a study by Will Mandy from London, from ALSPAC, which is a large epidemiological study taking one region of England. And they looked at autistic traits measured by parent report. It's not a fantastic measure. It would pick up other things because it's about both socially disruptive behavior as well as socially unusual behavior. But taking the data as it stands, what he finds is that the boys have more significant difficulties, but you can see the boys are the higher slope, but they don't get worse in adolescence, whereas the girls start off lower, and then in those teenage years, the high rates of those difficulties are really increasing. And I think that fits a lot of what we would find in individual cases and in clinical experience, that girls are often managing in early school years, and it's only when they get either to the more complex situations, social situations of later school years, or maybe when puberty and hormonal influences come in, that the differences really start to emerge and often lead to some kind of breakdown, unfortunately. A fourth reason has to do with what's been called camouflaging. So this really comes from listening to autistic women and girls, and some autistic men and boys as well, who tell us that they work very, very hard to blend in, that they will, for example, choose a girl at school or a woman in their workplace who seems socially successful and copy everything about her, how she dresses, how she does her hair, how she talks, what she talks about, how she walks, everything, so that they will pass as neurotypical. And sadly, this is often to avoid bullying or negative attention and negative attitudes that they've experienced when they've shown more of their authentic autistic self or shown more autistic-like behaviors. So this is just one quote from NeuroRebel on Twitter. "I remember the decision to put on the mask the summer before I started at a new school. I was tired of being bullied. I studied movies to learn how to be a cool kid." And it's very representative of what a lot of autistic people tell us. So this is just one study that we've done, in fact, in a general population sample, but will include some people diagnosed or undiagnosed with high autistic traits. And we use the Camouflaging of Autistic Traits questionnaire, the CAT-Q. And this asks you to rate how much you agree or disagree with statements, such as when I'm interacting with someone, I deliberately copy their body language or facial expressions. I learn how people use their bodies and faces to interact by watching TV or films. So those kinds of intention to camouflage questions. And what we found was that in this general population sample of young adults, how much you said you camouflaged was strongly correlated, positively correlated, with how many autistic traits you reported. So those who reported more autistic traits on the autism quotient also reported doing more camouflaging. This was true for males and for females. And in fact, overall, the males reported camouflaging a bit more than females, but perhaps because they also report higher autistic traits in general. But sadly, how much you said you camouflaged was negatively correlated with how you self-reported your quality of life. So people who were camouflaging more also reported lower quality of life, and that was true for both males and females. Now, a correlation is not causation. We don't know which direction this is being driven. You can imagine both directions would make sense, or there could be a third factor influencing both. But I think it's an important reminder that people who are doing well, looking less autistic, aren't necessarily feeling well about that. So camouflaging can also be measured in another way, which is by looking at the discrepancy between how somebody appears on the outside on something like the ADOS, where autistic behaviors and interaction styles are rated, and how somebody is internally. And you can measure that either by asking them themselves about their autistic traits, or what we've tended to do is to give them some kind of cognitive task that we think taps into the different cognitive style, the different thinking style that continues to be characteristic of autistic people, even when they've put on the mask, as it were. So this is a study by Mengxuang Lai, and we've done similar studies. So here they compare that external appearance on the ADOS with internal status from self-reported autism quotient and the reading the mind in the eyes task. And you might know this test from Simon Baron Cohen's group, where you have to decide which of the words, sarcastic, stern, dispirited, or suspicious, best capture what the person whose eyes you can see is feeling or experiencing. So what you can see in the graph is that you can create a discrepancy score. So some people will look very neurotypical on the ADOS and yet do very poorly on the reading the mind in the eyes task. And that suggests that they are masking while still being genuinely very autistic in their thinking style. So you can see that there's lots of overlap between the females in red and the males in blue-green. But on average, the females are doing more of this camouflaging measured in this discrepancy way. And this is just a study to note that what we think we know from neuroimaging studies, largely conducted with males, may not transfer or generalize to females. So the details aren't that important, and you can go and read the study if you're interested. But what they found was that there was a region in the medial prefrontal cortex which had been associated in studies of males with being underactivated in autistic males compared to neurotypical males during tasks where you have to think about your preferences and characteristics compared to somebody else's. But this area wasn't underactivated in females. And they also found that there was an area that in females only, activation correlated with camouflaging as measured by this discrepancy definition. So what we know about autism from males may not generalize to females. So Lucy Livingston, an ex-PhD student of mine, and I have been trying to think more deeply about camouflaging as just one aspect of what you might call compensation. We know that some children who are easy to diagnose as autistic in childhood, when they're teenagers or young adults, it may be very hard for anyone to see their autism. They may apparently have grown out of their autism. And we ask the question, does that mean that you can grow up out of autism? That the internal, the cognitive, the thinking style, the way of seeing the world, which is often a beautiful way of seeing the world with lots of strengths as well as challenges, does that mean that's gone away? Or does it mean that the person has built layers of compensation to deal with living in a neurotypical world? To think about compensation, we've thought about a metaphor with, for example, if you're visually impaired. So we thought about shallow compensation and deep compensation. If you're visually impaired, to get from A to B without knocking into something, you might use a white stick, a white cane, and that will get you safely from one place to another. But it's shallow compensation in the sense that it doesn't build up for you a rich spatial map of the world, which is what vision allows sighted people to do. But some visually impaired people use echolocation, so they can make sounds and hear them bounce off objects and walls and build up a rich spatial, albeit not visual, map of the world, and they can get from A to B without knocking into anything. And I would call that deep compensation, because they have created a representation, a spatial representation, just as we create a spatial, in our case, visual spatial representation. And so we've been thinking about compensation at different levels. And without going into too much detail, we've looked at, again, a discrepancy definition, young people who look very neurotypical on the ADOS, and yet on theory of mind tasks, perform in a very autism characteristic way, so they have a deeply autistic thinking style. And we found that high compensators compared to low compensators are better in IQ, better in executive functions. That makes sense. Those things are really going to help you develop those conscious and sometimes unconscious compensatory strategies. But those who are high compensators self-report more anxiety than low compensators. So again, that sense that there is some cost. Again, it's correlation, not causation, but one possibility, one hypothesis, that there is a cost to doing this. And we followed this up with a qualitative exploration of self-reported compensation strategies and feelings about compensation in both autistic and non-autistic people. And we asked really about compensatory strategies to get by in social situations. And we used qualitative thematic analysis. And again, I won't go into detail. You can read the paper, but I want to zoom in on some of the themes that were extracted. So people talked about the effect of quality of life, that it both helped them in some roles in society to be able to compensate in this world, but that it also affected in some ways their social relationships because they didn't feel authentic. And I'll always remember a 16-year-old young woman, autistic woman, that I spoke to who was telling me about the mental health crisis that she'd had, and she'd ended up in hospital. And when she came out of hospital, she described to me how her friends had really rallied around her and supported her. And I was thinking as she was talking, that's really wonderful. That's such a lot of really meaningful support. And then she said, but of course it's not me that they're friends with. It's the mask that I wear. And so all of that love, all of that support wasn't reaching her because she didn't feel that she was her authentic self and therefore their affection for her somehow also wasn't authentic. But I also want to point out that one of the themes that emerged from what people told us was the possible impact on diagnosis and support. So somebody saying, I did well on the IQ test and kept my head down, and other people saying, there's the risk that in that short time when I'm being assessed by a clinician, my compensation, my mask is going to be so good that they don't see that I'm autistic. So it's clear from our work and others that autistic women and girls and men, when they say they camouflage and compensate, they find this exhausting. You can imagine if it's like speaking a foreign language 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Some feel they're not their authentic self. There are high rates of anxiety and depression in autism, and we know that autistic women in particular, autistic women without intellectual disability in particular, at elevated risk of suicide. What role does late diagnosis, perhaps related to compensation, play in this? So this is work in progress in a sample which is population-based. It happens to be a twin sample that we followed from quite early on, and we met them all when they were around 13, and we've followed them again and met them when they were around age 22. And I just wanted to show you both of the distribution of ages at diagnosis shows that same trend of the women being on average diagnosed later, in this case around 12 or 13 years compared to 9 years in the boys. Again, there's a big spread. But in particular, to think about the correlations with age of diagnosis and whether things that correlate with age of diagnosis differ by sex. So IQ. IQ is positively related to age at diagnosis, but only for females. So females who are more intellectually able, on average, get diagnosed later, but that's not true for boys. Camouflaging, self-reported camouflaging, is positively correlated with age at diagnosis, but only for females. So women who tell us they're doing a lot or trying to do a lot of camouflaging are diagnosed later. But see the last one, quality of life, is negatively, strongly negatively correlated with age at diagnosis for both men and women. So the last empirical study I'm going to mention is, again, a qualitative study. And we did this right at the beginning of a project to try and gather the views of autistic women and girls to direct where our subsequent research went. And this was done by Victoria Milner, who went on to do a PhD with me, and Dr. Emma Colvett and Holly McIntosh, who was a placement student with us. And they had focus groups or single interviews, where that was preferred, with autistic women and girls and the mothers of young autistic girls. And there were questions on a number of topics. And I'll just give you a whistle-stop tour of some of the themes that emerged. So the first was about fitting in with a norm. So an autistic woman saying, all my life, it's like I didn't fit in, like I had friends and they weren't proper friends and I'd fall out with them. And a mum of autistic girls saying she's exhausted just by the business of running an ordinary life. And then people talked about obstacles. One autistic woman said that the trouble with female ASD is that in that time slot of whether you're going to say yes or no to your diagnosis, you could be performing or camouflaging so well that they're not going to see that, again echoing that previous theme. And an older woman saying, back in the day, they didn't really help me. They just put me down to really being a naughty child. We hear that again and again. Negative impacts for autistic women and girls. One autistic young woman who said, I'm prey in the world of predators. And another who said that puberty and periods and relationships and sex and all that kind of stuff, that was incredibly difficult growing up. But people also talked about positive impacts. So late diagnosed woman saying, I'm starting to appreciate more and more that, like, the way I see the world is, can be a benefit. And it's part of what makes me me. So yeah, I'm happy, you know, it's there. I certainly wouldn't take it away. And one mum saying she has this fantastic moral compass and she always wants to stick up for people. So from all this research, we can really see that there are layers of bias. There are so many hurdles you have to jump to get to a diagnosis. So first, if you feel different, you have to think, maybe this is autism. You either have to feel different if you're self-identifying or look different if somebody outside is going to help a child. And then they've got to think, got to get over their own biases to think, maybe this is autism. And then they've got to get past the clinical opinion, and certainly in the UK, the general practitioners who don't know very much about autism, and they will say, to a woman going for, asking to be referred for an autism assessment, they'll laugh at them and say, you're making eye contact, you're married, you've got kids, you can't be autistic. The myths are still really entrenched. And that's very traumatic for a lot of autistic women and men. So the diagnosing criteria and tools may also not be fair. And this is why, as I mentioned, if we only do diagnosis on people who have managed to get through all those hurdles, they are the tip of the iceberg. And it is going to be circular because they've met criteria by criteria that may not be fair to all women and girls. So we have to do diagnosis in the general population. Future research priorities. As I mentioned, that may be circular. We have to do population-based studies. We need to look at undiagnosed girls in vulnerable groups like the homeless, those in prison, those excluded from school. Research needs to identify if our diagnostic criteria and processes are gender fair or how to improve them if they're not. And we know next to nothing about autistic experiences of pregnancy and menopause and other female experiences. Our ultimate aim is to improve recognition, understanding, and support for women and girls on the autism spectrum. And the book that Michael mentioned has chapters by women, by teachers, by parents, by girls, girls from an all-girls autism special school in the UK. It's just one that is state-provided. But apart from the book, there's also a free guide from NASEN, and you can download that for free, and it's particularly directed at teachers. So for anyone struggling to communicate with teachers about female presentation, that could be useful. And in conclusion, then, to recap, autism is a behavioral diagnosis that leaves us with challenges when the behavioral presentation isn't what we're expecting traditionally. We've known little about autistic women and girls historically. We're catching up now. And there are probably many more autism spectrum females than we thought. Are our diagnostic processes fair to girls? And we should remember that doing well by camouflaging or compensating may have a cost to well-being. And I think that's also made me think differently about social skills interventions, which, again, I'm happy to talk about if you want to ask questions. More research and awareness is needed. And I wanted to give, if you don't mind, the last word to autistic women and girls in a very short film made by Cary Grant in the UK, who worked with the Forum for Autistic Girls that I was part of. And if you don't mind, it's shorter than 5 minutes, I think, and I think you'll like it.
Autistic girls and women and their families, it's time to raise our voices.
Autism is okay to have. I think people need to know more about it.
If you meet an autistic person, please do not say that they look normal or that they are good at fooling people. This is not a compliment.
It's really difficult when people say, oh, I'm a little bit autistic, or they tell you that you don't look autistic.
I often feel misunderstood and people assume I'm okay because I look normal.
When something comes unexpectedly, it makes me melt down, like when they took away topic homework.
It's hard in the world. It's loud, it's bright.
We want acceptance and understanding that autism doesn't necessarily present the same way in girls as it does in boys, but that doesn't make it any less real.
I'm good at contortion.
What are you good at? Shut
up.
I find it hard to sit still and concentrate.
I was always excluded at school, and now I don't go.
I'm an autistic mum, and I would like more awareness.
I think people need to know more about it.
If you meet an autistic person, please do not say that they look normal or that they are good at fooling people. This is not a compliment.
It's really difficult when people say, oh, I'm a little bit autistic, or they tell you that you don't look autistic.
I often feel misunderstood and people assume I'm okay because I look normal.
When something comes unexpectedly, it makes me melt down, like when they took away topic homework.
It's hard in the world. It's loud, it's bright.
We want acceptance and understanding that autism doesn't necessarily present the same way in girls as it does in boys, but that doesn't make it any less real.
I'm good at contortion.
What are you good at?
Shut up.
I find it hard to sit still and concentrate.
I was always excluded at school, and now I don't go.
I'm an autistic mum, and I would like more awareness raised within mainstream schools for my autistic children.
We want schools that work for everyone.
We want more awareness and autism-friendly places to go.
No one tells this girl what to do unless she wants to do it.
It's hard for other family members to get it.
I struggle with a lot of anxiety.
Anxiety in autistic girls can have a big impact on what can or can't be achieved. It's hard because I spend all my energy masking my autism instead of using it to learn at school.
I challenge you to live in a world where you're never allowed to finish what you're thinking and where you're never allowed to actually say everything that you want to say. I challenge you not to get angry, not to get annoyed, not to get fed up.
I'm exhausted every day from just trying to fit in.
I want to understand the links between autism and mental health.
It's hard because I get overwhelmed so easily.
I'm a great big sister. I love Harry Potter, but I struggle with the muggles.
I'm autistic. It affects my brain and the way I might hurt people. People don't understand me.
My daughter's at university. She believes and I believe that anything is possible, especially with the right support. I'm really, really proud of her.
My strength is being able to hyper-focus. I've nearly finished a counselling degree and will be getting a Dean's Award at the end of this month.
Employers keep talking about flexible work opportunities, but what we want is more opportunities for women with ASD because they can add so much.
My strengths are making cakes. I'm currently setting up my own business.
I passed my maths GCSE and I'm doing an apprenticeship in hospitality and I'm really enjoying it.
Work's been really amazing because the people that I'm working with really get me.
My daughter has far more talents than issues, developed those talents and have had teachers rewarded for that, not for exam results.
I would like to see more specialised schools accessible for our children in local areas. And in the meantime, I'd like the mainstream schools to have much better provisions put in place for our children.
All our doctors and nurses to be trained in autism and or learning disability awareness.
Autism should not mean mental health.
We want autism diagnosis to be people-centred, not male-centred.
What I want is early identification for girls so that people don't grow up feeling broken like I did.
8 years to get my daughter diagnosed.
I want schools to understand that when girls are falling apart out of school, are self-harming, have eating disorders, are depressed, have anxiety, that just because it's not happening at school doesn't mean the school doesn't have any responsibility to try and fix that problem.
My strength is singing and songwriting. When you take the time to listen to my language, you'll clearly hear what my heart is saying.
I see autism as my super strength, as it allows myself and my children to be heard.
Even though autism could be hard, I'll never give up, I'm determined, and I'm there to help others.
I want to be a teacher when I'm older so I can help people like me.
My strength is pushing myself when everyone else says I can't.
My strength is to speak up for people who cannot speak up for themselves.
I'm good at swimming and singing.
My greatest strength is my empathy with animals.
My strength is following my dreams and never giving up, no matter what challenges get in my way.
What do you love?
Mommy, Daddy, Corey, and Tango.
I am kind and caring. I'm good at colouring.
My strength is iPads and technology.
My autism helps with my pattern finding and puzzles.
Girls can have autism too.
Autism makes me fun.
Girls with autism are sassy.
Naturally, autism's been really amazing for me because I wrote a short story about it, it went viral, and now I'm publishing a book.
I like to draw and imagine things and draw the things I imagine.
I'm really good at art and painting.
To finally realise who you are and what you have been is the most profound feeling. When you finally realise, I found my people.
With the right support, I can change the world.
So Professor Happé has agreed to field some questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand and someone will come to you with a microphone. We need you to speak into the microphone so that your question can be recorded.
Sorry. Thank you, all the Michael, for inviting me and all the participants who've helped with our research and our autistic consultants as well and my PhD students and colleagues that I really were behind this work. And thank you for your attention.
Now, we still have time for questions.
Yes, questions, please.
Yes.
Most of the diagnoses for women
the increase is coming out of the West. What have your colleagues in Asia and the Global South and other places noticed about diagnosis of autism in women?
It's a really good question. I mean, as you know, of course, historically there's been a terrible inequality that although 80% of autistic people live in low and middle income countries, 80% of research has happened in a few privileged Western countries, high income countries. So the catch up in terms of just doing epidemiological work in low and middle income countries is happening now. And a lot of that work is starting with children, and it's starting with screening of children for autism and or developmental disabilities. So screening population level, including adults and including those who have good intellectual functioning, will come later because the needs are different. But it's a very good question, and I ought to ask colleagues in Japan, because there they have done epidemiological work for quite a long time in autism, so it would be interesting to know. I did speak to one colleague working in Japan who happens to work in an adult clinic for autism and ADHD, and she had a very interesting perspective. She's just at the beginning of her research. Interesting perspective on how, in Japan in particular, the ideal of how a woman is very out of keeping, particularly with ADHD. So you are to be contained, and you are to be quiet, and you are to be small in every sense, and organized. And so the ADHD kind of phenotype is very mismatched with that, and she's looking at whether there's more stigma for that reason. But it's a great question for which I don't think we have the answer yet, unless you're aware of research in that area. But it's a really good question.
I'm a clinician, and so I see a lot of adults, and I've been trying to screen more for autism and ADHD. I don't feel exactly prepared to do it, but I'm doing it. And I'm noticing a lot of overlap between ADHD and autism. If you know how comorbid ADHD affects the presentation and diagnosis and misdiagnose.
So you're absolutely right.
More risk of mental health difficulties, and when you have both, you have more than just one. But it doesn't seem to be a whole different animal, as it were. It doesn't bring a whole new set of risks. It's more additive. But really important, and also of course for ADHD, we can tell many of the same stories about late diagnosis in women, slightly different presentation in women, sex stereotypes about what ADHD looks like. So yes, really important.
I think the reason that they're not diagnosed is because parents don't have any idea what it is. Our daughter was perfect, there was nothing wrong with her. And until one day the principal at the elementary school recommended that we have her diagnosed for her. So she was 10 when she got diagnosed because of them. And I was also diagnosed the same day with Asperger's by my wife. But people just don't know. They don't understand. So it's not something to be ashamed of. It's something to be, like in our case, to be proud of. People understood that. It's always easier.
Yeah, absolutely. I sometimes think that it would be great to have a sort of public understanding information campaign, because so often people are thinking when they go to their GP, their general practitioner, they come to first port of call to ask for a diagnosis track, they get laughed at, they get met with these stereotypes, that in every GP's office there should be a big poster that shows lots and lots of pictures of women and girls, police women and fire women and every type and shape and size and colour
and whatever, and all of them saying I'm autistic, because we just don't remember that autism comes in so many different, you know, flavours and shapes, and it's absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. It has its strengths and it has its challenges like everything does. But it's so common that autistic girls manage and mask and cope and copy until they get to a certain age when the demands of neurotypical life, where we haven't suited it, we haven't accommodated autism, just become overwhelming. And sadly, then it can lead to meltdowns and to mental health crises and so on. And also very common that once one person in the family is diagnosed, others read around it and say, that's me too. And I've found lots of families where that's actually very helpful, that parents will say, I always knew that for my son who's diagnosed autistic, I shouldn't like bombard him with emotional questions or ask him to decide on things when he's in a heightened emotional state. I would leave him a note or voicemail or something that he could read when he wanted to and re-listen to process. I never thought to do that with my husband, but now I will, because I realize it's not that he doesn't care or he doesn't want to listen to me. It's that if I go in there, all emotions blazing, that drowns out whatever else I'm trying to say. So I think you're right, we just need better understanding.
Yeah, a two-sided trifold document should be given to the parents when they take the kids home. And they would discover more about themselves in the process.
Yeah. I'm quite encouraged that in some schools in the UK, teachers, because there's a long wait for diagnosis in the UK, and a lot of teachers are saying, we don't wait for the diagnosis. If it looks like autism, we do the things we know work well for autistic people, because actually what works well for autistic children in school works well for everyone. Be clear, be fair, be transparent, be systematic, be organized, give warnings about change and so on. So while there's such a long delay for diagnosis, I'm really glad if when teachers recognize it, they teach to it regardless.
Eleanor.
Hi, I'm Eleanor. I'm an autistic student here, and as I've grown up, my parents have encouraged me to advocate for myself more in academic settings. I started doing it later on in high school, and I consider myself more adept at it now than I ever was before. But sometimes I find it difficult to explain. I don't know it sometimes if my professors take me seriously because of, I don't know if it's the way I explain it or I try to overcompensate by over-explaining. I don't know how to make them understand exactly what I'm experiencing and how I struggle. And I don't know, I suppose, I'm wondering if there are any ways that I could better communicate with my professors versus, you know, everyday people, I suppose.
Well, I think you have some wonderful professors to ask. I'm sure you're doing a terrific job, and I hope that your professors are also asking you about what works best for you. I have two PhD students who are autistic, and they've taught me such a lot, and I always ask them, you know, what's working for you? What works? What doesn't work? What should we do differently? But we can learn such a lot and we listen, but I'm sure you're doing a fantastic job.
If I can just interrupt just very briefly, on May 16th, we will be hosting a workshop here at St. Mary's, understanding and supporting college students on the spectrum. It's targeted for college faculty members. If you are a faculty member who is interested in that workshop, you can go to stmarys.edu/autismworkshops or see me afterward and I'll help you get information about that.
First of all, I just want to thank you for your work. There's not enough attention that's been given to this topic, and I just want to thank you for
that
and for bringing that to us. As a school psychologist, one of the discoveries I stumbled onto is the importance of when you're assessing females for autism, to use the person as an informant for a lot of the tools. And one of the things that I am struggling with as a practitioner is what are some good tools to get at that, you know, the slide that you showed with internal versus external. Mm-hmm. Because girls are so effective at masking, even teachers that know them really well will rate them as being more proficient with things than they are. And yet, when I talk with the individual student and they'll say, you know, in this particular, and at one particular instance, there was a student that had was in theater. And she said, I have spent years studying how to act to be, you know, in certain ways, but inside, I don't have a clue. So my question to you, is there any research that anybody's doing about, first of all, the importance of trying to develop tools to assess those internal states and developing those tools?
So it's a brilliant question. There are people I'm working with who are looking at whether in the ADOS, in the Autism Diagnostic Observation Schedule, there are things that are currently not entered in the algorithm that could be better markers for in autistic women or atypical presentations of autism. That research may be helpful. Some people are using the CAT-Q, the camouflaging autistic traits, and just asking autistic women and girls and men to say, you know, how much are you working hard to do this? In the DSM-5, when I was involved with the DSM-5, somebody told me nobody reads the text. They only read those criteria, and it's true. And I spent a long time writing text, some of which got cut out, which was really saying, ask the adult, ask them what it costs. Ask them, when they finish here in this diagnostic assessment, what are they going to go and do now? And when they say, I'm going to go home and I'm going to have to lie in a dark room for 3 hours, that's not what happens for everyone. Or not even after diagnostic assessment. After you've been out, you know, with friends, what are you going to do? So what does it cost somebody? And people can tell you. And also, what would you be doing? You know, if you had a camera in your house when you're alone, what would it show you doing for fun? You know, and you know, some people are doing unusual things at home that they're not going to do in front of a clinician.
And that's where, like, questions like, and I don't even remember where I pulled these from, but one of the questions, there was a set of questions I asked this gal that were so enlightening, like, tell me about your best friend. And she told me, and I said, what's something that your best friend would find funny? Mm-hmm. Blank, no clue. Who's your favorite teacher? How do you know when that teacher's upset? Mm-hmm. I don't know, I have to ask my classmates. So, I mean, I guess I would love to see, like, somebody systematize that, you know, the questions that you pose, some of these, like, a tool that could help quantify, like, you know, more systematically, what those internal thought processes are, and assessing theory of mind in a sense.
So we have, that's a great idea, and that would be a beautiful piece of co-produced research, wouldn't it, with the autistic community?
So I'm encouraging you.
Yeah. but I would say that from the work I told you about with Lucy Livingston, looking at compensatory strategies, she has created a sort of checklist of strategies that people tell us they use. And it's not quite the same thing, because you're asking about probes for differences that aren't obvious, but it might also be useful in some settings. So thank you.
Hello, thank you. I have a question about social skills training. It occurred to me as you were talking about camouflaging and masking, that it's possible the way that social skills training is currently carried out, I'm thinking of Pierce, for example, out of UCLA, could exacerbate, right, or contribute to masking or camouflaging in women, and also that perhaps they are already doing their own, like, self-social skills training if they are learning strategies to look or appear normal. And I'm wondering if you've looked at this or if you think that perhaps social skills training should look different for women than it currently does.
So thank you. It's a really good question. And I'm not an expert in social skills training, so I'm speaking sort of from outside and certainly not about any specific social skills training. But the work that we've done and this sense of not feeling authentic has made me think that at least the old model of social skills training, where you bring in a lot of autistic teenagers and you tell them how to do social, we are effectively saying, what you do, your social's not good enough, and you need to do it our way. And traditionally, a lot of the ways that we interact with autistic people, even when we're trying to help, do send the messages, you're broken, let me fix you. And we really can't do that. I mean, that's not in keeping with a sort of neurodiversity movement. But Offa Golan and others have this nice metaphor for, thinking about social skills training almost like second language learning. So when, I want to suggest you learn French, I don't say English is a terrible language, you must never use it, it's rubbish, you must only speak French. I say English is great, you speak English. French, if you learn to speak French, there are some other things you can do, some other places you can go, some other people you can talk to that you might enjoy. But it doesn't devalue in any sense your primary language. And I think that social skills training can be taught like that, with a lot of respect and with recognition that we're not saying your way is wrong, but that here's another way, or here's a suit of armor to put on when you're going out there. If you're going to a different culture, you might be told there are things you should and shouldn't do. And that's not saying those are bad things to do or you can't do them in your home culture. It's just that to fit in, to not offend, to go smoothly, these are the rules there. So I don't know if that answers, but okay, thank you.
Everything you're saying is resonating. I could go through stories, everything you said. Thank you. What I'm wondering in this moment, I don't know if this is your expertise, but do you have any thoughts or suggestions about resources for a teenage girl who wants to find her people?
So there are writings by autistic people, including the autistic special school for girls that I mentioned, which is called Limpsfield Grange, but I can send you the details via Michael or if you email me. But they've written, as a school, the pupils have written two books, I think, about autism, so that might be a nice perspective. And I know for autistic, especially newly diagnosed women, they often find their tribe online, but I don't know whether there are safe communities for young autistic girls, and some of the people here I'm sure will know, and social groups and so on. But certainly in terms of reading, there's quite a lot out there now, I think, that could make someone feel that they're not alone with their autism. Thank you.
If that young person is local and is in middle school or high school, we might have some options to help as well if you see me afterward.
So my question is about the fact that the diagnosis is coming so much later, and I mean well into adulthood for some people. And so what's a little kind of unsettling for me is when they're diagnosed early, there's school, there's, you know, so what is, are there more supports and services being looked at, provided? What happens once an adult gets this diagnosis? Yeah. Do they just feel like, oh, great, now I can say that I'm autistic, but does that help them? Then what?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Did you get the question on mic, or did you want me to? You did. Okay, sorry, I couldn't hear whether the mic was on or not. It's a really good question, and I do find because the diagnostic center located in my university, it sometimes sees people coming for first diagnosis in their 70s, and there are mixed emotions, both of feeling you understand why you've been felt different on your life, but also sometimes grieving for time lost when you could have had a different understanding. And of course, often those journeys have been of misdiagnosis and mistreatment and bullying and really, really hard lives. So it is very sad. I have to say, I have had doctors, including, again, general practitioners, when I've given talks, particularly about aging, actually, in autism, say, what on earth's the point of giving an autism diagnosis to a 70-year-old? But if they're not appreciating that for that 70-year-old, it makes a huge difference of self-understanding and of explaining to others how they're different, and of understanding that they're not alone. And sadly, often, people diagnosed late in life, the first thing they'll say will be, does this mean I'm not stupid? And often these are people with incredibly high IQs, but you can see that if you have no other explanation for why you don't understand sometimes how the rest of the world does things socially, you might think you're stupid. You're going to find an explanation for yourself somehow. So I think it is really important to have a diagnosis at any age. We should bring it younger whenever we can. Are there resources? It's very patchy in the UK. you're absolutely right, unlike diagnosis in childhood, where it gives you right to provision to certain sorts of schooling and support, in adulthood, it usually doesn't bring anything much by way of benefits and so on. If you're in work, it gives you a legal right to reasonable accommodations in work, which aren't always respected. In some parts of the country, in the UK, there are services. In fact, the best services are available for people who are on that diagnostic journey, even if they're not diagnosed yet, because we know that people wait for years on diagnostic waiting lists. So there are some support services. There is a sense of finding your tribe that can be therapeutic. But yes, there needs to be much, much more. You're absolutely right.
So before I ask my question, I wanted to say Instagram has really great autistic communities for autistic adults and teenagers. So, So I guess my question is mostly out of curiosity. I was raised by an autistic parent who was diagnosed in her 50s. We have this terminology called code switching. I don't know if you guys have heard of that, but code switching is essentially code switching, where depending on the environment that you're in, you change the way that you talk, right? So we're part of the diaspora, so we lived in a lot of different places. And so when my mother got her diagnosis, they told her that was probably really beneficial, that we learned, like, we had moved so many times, so you're never really part of the group, but you recognize that you have to change to some degree, right? I guess my question is now, this is on a side point, but now that there's so much research about adults, is there any research about their children coming out? Because that is I learned when I was in college, graduate school already, and so that made a lot of my childhood make sense. But I would be curious to see what information there is about the children and that experience, just because it is different. That's probably also a really great reason to discuss early diagnosis, because I think if we had known the diagnosis earlier, that also would have helped in a lot of ways too. But I'm just curious if there is any research on that.
That's a really interesting point and a really interesting question. Yeah. So the point about code switching is very, very relevant. And people also talk, within reputation management, but code switching, it also reminds us to think about intersectionality, where again, that's been understudied in autism in terms of, being multiple minority. Yes. People have looked at how and whether being recognized or labeled as an outsider by nationality is a disguising factor in autism. So, and also speculations about individuals who might marry somebody from a very different culture and whether therefore their differences are put down to being English, he's not very emotional with me because he's English rather than, or we don't meet in terms of sense of humor because he's English and I'm Italian or something. In terms of autistic parents and the experience of being parented by an autistic parent, I don't think there is any research that I know of, certainly not much research, and it would be a really interesting thing, again, to co-create with the offspring of autistic parents that I only know anecdotally, particularly about families where a child gets diagnosed and then a parent is diagnosed afterwards, and how that is sometimes really helpful to have that common experience of autism, although sometimes also difficult. So I remember one family where the father and son were both autistic, and the father couldn't accept that his son wouldn't be interested in trains because that's what he was interested in, because he was so fascinated by trains he couldn't conceive of the fact that his son was fascinated by birds or something else. But only at anecdotal level. That would be a fantastic piece of work. Thank you.
We'll make this one the last question, I think.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your presenting. I really appreciate it. I actually am an ABA provider, and I work with children who are girls on the spectrum, and which is why I was really interested in coming today. Most of my clients have been boys, so a lot of the things you said really resonated with me, but because I am providing services, there are certain programs that I've really kind of struggled implementing with my girls because they understand so much more than a lot of my male clients. And I was just wondering if there's any like specific programming or things that I could look into to expand my knowledge to help out my clients.
I don't know of any randomized controlled trials that have looked at different interventions by gender or sex. I don't know of any work on that yet. It's a very good question. And there might be clinical wisdom in this room that you can tap into.
I've actually asked one very well-known high-profile clinician, whose name I won't mention, about doing just that sort of study, and was met with sort of a blank stare. So I think that's really something that we need to think about. Sorry. Well, I want to be mindful of your time. I appreciate all of you making time to be here with us today, and I'd like to ask you to join me in thanking Professor Happé for her
time. Thank you. Thank you for all your fantastic questions. Really good.